I just want to say about on something, and then practically, if you don't mind, we'll do something practical, and then we'll look a bit funny, but I think it's very, 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 very necessary. And I again want to share, because this topic coming and coming back to me, about epikaiso, They're about seven words, power words in the New Testament. Dunamis, ischus, kratos, energia, harpazo, and the seventh one is epikaiso. It's a Greek word, epikaiso. And epikaiso is the highest power available to men. There is nothing higher on the face of this earth than to walk in the epikaiso power. And I believe we need to start learning and consciously start applying that power in our lives. So what is the epikaiso? It's an overshadowing power. Overshadowing. It's an overshadowing as the highest manifestation of God's power. God's presence overshadows, overtakes, overwhelms men and causes the physical faculties of men to lose their earthly essence and take upon the form of the spirit. Nature is quickened by immense concentration of power to materialize into supernatural. This is epikaiso. Moses was 40 days and 40 nights on the mountain of Sinai. It's epikaiso. He was directly overshadowed by the glory and power of God. There are four references of epikaiso in the New Testament. First one, Luke 1:35. The Holy Spirit shall come upon you, and the epikaiso of the Most High shall overshadow you. So this angel Gabriel speaks to Mary. Holy Spirit shall come upon you, and the epikaiso of the Most High shall overshadow you. And then there will be the impregnation of the holy thing, holy seed, whom you call Jesus, and so on and so forth. So the purpose of epikaiso is multifunctional. One of the first functions to come and overshadow us, that the impregnation, the seed of the Holy Word may come into us, that we may become pregnant. Overshadowing, it's like man overshadows the woman. It's God overshadows us and releases the holy seed, releases the promise or releases the ministry or whatever it is into us for the Son of God to manifest through us. And I believe we need to desire it and we need to pray about it because there are references in the Word. Epikaiso. Epi means over. Over. And kaiso means to block. To block something with shadow. To block something with shadow. Those who dwell in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the epikaiso, shadow of the Almighty. And we will just look later what the shadow is. And it says that in the last days, after God purged the filth of the daughter of Zion with the spirit of fire and the spirit of judgment, it's a baptism of fire, He will create over every place of the assemblies of the Mount Zion, overshadowing, chupa, of the cloud and smoke during the day, and of the burning, blazing fire during the night, so that over every glory shall be the canopy, or the canopy of glory shall be as a chuppa in the original, covering us. Actually, we are supposed to walk always in that covering, under the cover of that epikaizo. So definitely, what is another function of epikaizo is to defend and to protect. And it says, and there will be a canopy for protection against the heat and against the rain. I think because we haven't explored this area, we still get bombarded by certain things, and we are not properly defended. It's the manifestation of overshadowing power where all natural laws are cancelled in obedience to God who is a spirit. Now imagine what it actually happens when the dunamis manifests. Demons must leave. You have a dunamis power and you command demons to leave, they leave. But when the epikaisa comes, they disintegrate, they stop existing. They just come. I mean, they're no more. When the dunamis manifests, sicknesses get healed. People get healed from sicknesses. When epikaisa, overshadowing power, comes, diseases just disintegrate, they don't exist anymore. All the natural laws and everything which is contrary to God stops existing, because the shadow of God blocks everything from working and from operating. Absolutely everything. Luke 9:34. We will not open the scriptures for the sake of time, because there are things to share. What happened? They are on the mountain of transfiguration. Jesus gets transfigured, three of his disciples, Peter, John and James, they're on the mountain. And eventually what happens, it says, and the cloud overshadowed them, epikaiso. So this cloud comes, overshadows them, and the voice of the Father comes from the cloud. This is my beloved Son, listen to him. And it said that they were pretty scared when this voice came from the cloud. So Father speaks to us from the cloud. Father speaks to us and his voice is released from the cloud. That's why there's an overshadowing of the cloud, is overshadowing of the Father. It's the power of the Father, epikaiso. Power of the Most High. It's not just the power of the Holy Spirit, which is, we understand it, wonderful and so on. Acts 5:12-15. It says that there was such a great revival that the people were brought out on the streets, so that the epikaiso of Peter might touch them. So the shadow of Peter, epikaiso of Peter. So what happened? When we learn to live under the shadow and learn to be overshadowed, we will start to overshadow things. We will start to overshadow things, and we will later, some other time, explore this area, overshadow things. So what happened there? The shadow of God became the shadow of man. The shadow of the Father became the shadow of Peter. And wherever Peter was walking, this just, he cast the shadow and things were changed. Epikaiso changes people into supernatural beings, literally. Every natural law becomes subjugated to the spiritual and higher law. So in that area where epikaiso overshadows, spiritual laws start operating and they dominate in that area. It means miracles, signs, wonders, miracles, non-stop. What happens also, everything that contradicts the presence of epikaiosa stops existing and dematerializes. And the fourth scripture where it says is 2 Corinthians 12:9, where Apostle Paul said that I would rather brag and boast about my weaknesses in order that Christ's power may overshadow me. Epikaiso me. So he was breaking his weaknesses that the power of Christ may overshadow. Epikaiso. And I believe in the last days now it becomes really, really, really very crucial. There, I wrote it. Ah, it's here. I want to bring to your attention two letters in Hebrew alphabet, because this is shade. Shadow. So we need to know what the shadow of God means. Shadow of the Almighty. El Shaddai. This is the word shadow. And it's interesting that this is tzed or tzaddik, which speaks about righteousness, about the way of righteousness, about righteous stronghold, tzaddik. It speaks about righteousness. And this is a lament, which speaks about staff, shepherd staff, the voice of authority of the shepherd, the voice of authority of the teacher. So, when do we walk in the shadow of the Almighty? In order for God to overshadow me. What is that shadow? It's actually the way of righteousness, or the dimension of righteousness, which get released through the voice of authority of the shepherd. So when I walk in obedience to the voice of authority of the shepherd, the righteous one, he is the righteous one, overshadows me. This is where the shadow is the created. Because unrighteousness can't dwell under the shadow. It's just impossible. It's also interesting that tzaddik number, it's the equivalent of 90. You know, Hebrew, each letter has got a numerical number. It's the number 90, which speaks of righteousness, humility, desire, and harvest. And lamed, it's a 30. It's blood of Messiah, staff to teach, instruct. So with voice of authority, it also means with the voice of authority to control, urge forward, a tongue. So what it means that there is a way where we walk as a righteous in humility, which releases the shadow upon us, and this humility comes because of the blood of Jesus, what the blood of Jesus did for us. So over the pride, over the proud and exalted one, there is no overshadow, there is no canopy. Exercise. Ach Shaddai, we will... Okay, let us quickly bring Shaddai, but we will not write it. Look, you can release them if you need. Under the shadow of the Almighty, the word is Shaddai. The first letter, Shin. It's teeth and fire. Also, victory of good over evil. To consume all the enemies. Devour, destroy. Something sharp. Teeth, devour, fire. This is Shin letter. Shaddai, first one. Second one is Dalit, Do, creation. The third one, Yod, which is two out, right arm power, right hand of God's power. A deep down, to look, to cover, allow. So, if you can construct a little bit, what is, who is Shaddai? We abide under the fire of God who consumes our enemies at the door, which he's overseeing right hand of, with his oversight, where the right hand of power released. Repeat again. We abide in the shadow. We abide in the righteousness of the voice of authority of the shepherd, where his consuming fire destroys and devours our enemies at the door which he oversees with the right hand of power released. This is in the shadow of the Almighty, Psalm 91. And we dwell in the secret place of the Most High Elyon. And the root word for Elyon is to ascend, to ascend. That's why we need to live in the ascended life. We need to constantly be in the ascended state. There's a lot of things which still, which we will explore later. I believe even consciously, in your imagination, picture things. So what we did as a prep, I don't know who is just bothering me there. And we will explore more and more because this topic is, very, very deep. So you can make a study. You can make a study of that for yourself. I remember when we activated the Burl Wheat and the Burl Wheat in Russia. So what guys did, they were sitting and they were imagining, remember, the Burl Wheat over there and then inside of them, and they were connected. By the way, the Burl Wheat in the spirit, the Gal-Gal, whirling winds, will within the wind, Ezekiel, whirling wind. It actually looks like that. It's the two letters, which is Gimel, which speaks about foot and walking, and two letters, Lamed, which is the voice of authority of the shepherd. So, when are we moving in the whirling wind? When we walk in the authority of the voice of authority of the shepherd, that's it. This is the Galgal, Galgalim. This is what it really means. This is Galgal, Gel-Gel. As we walk in the authority of the shepherd, that's it. Okay, so, and then in one church, in one place, we did the corporate Galgal, where there were like a five or six circles, big circle, smaller circle, people were holding their hands. And we were moving about an hour and a half, praying and praising God. You know, it's like rotating. And the time, I don't know how, the time was compressed. It was 10-15 minutes on the watch, but in the reality it was an hour and a half. So I can't explain it, but we painted the time. So Galgal, it's a powerful thing. When we get into it, and when we start walking in a whirlwind, finished. I mean, this is how the prophets they walked, and it's also the way of overshadowing and everything. Okay, now some soon practical things that you can also write for yourself down. Some point. So, you know that the highest order of things in the spirit for us It's to become the thing. It's the highest order of things. Check it out. There was the tabernacle, but we are the tabernacle. Okay. There was altars in the Old Testament, but we are the altar of God. There is the Ark of the Covenant, but we are the Ark of the Covenant. Actually, overshadowing, powerful overshadowing, took place where in the Ark of the Covenant? Over the mercy seat. We, when we receive the revelation that we are the mercy seat, then the archangels will create a canopy over us. So, the highest order, and I want to take all this tabernacle, the temple in the Old Testament. We are the temple. You see, now the things became us. If we want to walk in the Spirit, there is no reason for us to study the tabernacle of Moses or the temple of Solomon unless we become it. In the temple of Solomon, there were two pillars. Yachin and Boaz. We will leave it for next time to see what they mean in Hebrew by each and every letter. But it's actually in Him is strength and He establishes. That's why in the Song of Songs, Jesus' feet like a marble pillars, established on the golden foundations. But if we know this, we need to apply it to us, that we need to become those pillars. We need to become it. Otherwise it will not function for us. We will learn all these teachings, but it will be the teaching and it will be us. Sanctuary, altar, most holy place. And I want to take it because we need to apply it, because we are the sanctuary now. We are the tabernacle. We are the most holy place. We are the altar. Alright. So, and again, in the book of Revelations, it says the principle. So, God says to John, go and measure the temple, the altar, and those who worship in it, and worshipers. Go measure the temple, the altar, and worshipers. It means not physical temple. It's not physical temple. You know, why sometimes we have so many problems in our soul, for instance. In our soul. And we go for, we don't go, praise the Lord, but to all these endless counselings and stuff, and you know. Why? Because you know that in the Solomon's temple, there was three stores. And you know how many rooms were in Solomon's temple? 90. 30 on each and every level. If we take it literally that the temple is us, imagine there is at least 90 rooms in our soul corresponding to the temple, which needed to be sorted out by God. At least 90. We used to see mind, emotion, you know, these three squares, like we were total waste. Mind, emotions, and will. And this is the soul, rubbish. 90 rooms at least. And in one room, everything can be dedicated to God, and we enjoy shalom, peace, prosperity. But another, there can be total chaos, and demons may sit there and do whatever they like. Because they flew through the windows. There were a lot of windows of the temple. You see, that's why the enemy can lurk in some room. And we know, like, even in our physical house, there are rooms which we regularly visit. Kitchen, But we don't go to the attic all the time. Or to the base. You know, sometimes, and then when you go there, there's a lot of dust, there's spiders and all sorts of things. So with our soul, some of the things, some of the doors are closed completely. This is for those who do deliverance also. I mean, my goodness, because we are the temple. So everything, all the parameters in the Old Testament, it's actually given to us. It's given to us. It's us. So measure the temple. So God is always measuring. We need to always pray that He measures us. Against what? Against His standard of righteousness. Who is that standard? Christ. There is no other measure. We don't measure ourselves against anointed men of God. We don't measure ourselves against the mystics of old. All of them, including them and us, we are measured according to the measure of Christ. Righteousness of Christ, standard of Christ. He is our plumb line of truth. Remember, truth and righteousness kissed each other. Righteousness came down from heaven. Truth, Psalm says, appeared from the earth. Righteousness and peace, they kissed each other. Truth and righteousness from the earth and from heaven. All right. So, we are the temple. And you know, I regularly started praying and saying, you know, measure your temple. Holy Spirit, expose any darkness in your temple. Our temple needs to be constantly scanned. Because tomorrow we can open the door for the enemy. And that's it. I remember in Stirlitamak, one lady, I started prophesying about her. And I said, there was something traumatic at the age of 7, 8, when you were 7 or 8. She doesn't remember, huh? She doesn't remember. And you see, when it happens, you have to run with the information you get from the Holy Spirit. You can't just run what men tell you.
Yeah.
And I thought, are you sure you don't even, no, there was nothing. So she's thinking like normal. I said, you know what? I'm going to go into this area because I feel the Lord told me. And I laid a hand on her and I said, now we are going into this area where you are 7 and 8. She fell down and started manifesting. And a few demons were cast out of her. Immediately, you know, the enemy kept hidden, kept secret something, even from her memory, to be recalled. And then we went there, enemy got exposed. So second, what we measure is the altar, and we are the altar. And the worshippers. The Lord is always coming to every service and measuring us. Measuring our altar, us as an altar, that is a sacrifice. And measuring us as the people, as a temple. So last time I wanted to share with you that there was a revelation through one pastor, and he actually prayed for me for that there needs to be altars established. Each and every church has got altar or altars in the spirit. Okay, let's say, is there altars in heaven? There is altars in heaven. So, okay, let us just like this altar. There is altars. There are multiple altars in heaven. Because from those altars were coals of fire taken from one of the altars of the seraphim, which touched the mouth of Isaiah. There are altars in heaven. Existing, really existing. Now, remember in the book of Revelation, the angel says, he took the prayers of the saints Remember, into the censer and poured it upon the altar. And when he poured it upon the altar, the prayers got connected with coals. When you pour something on coals, there is always something happening. The prayers, and then it says there go thunders and lightnings and voices and earthquakes released. Okay. Now, in the Bible we read, so it's in heavens. We will, Hester, you need somebody, Nathan, can you bring me the white thing because I need to wipe out something later. It's in the kitchen, at the dustbin, that cloth. No, not white, it's yellow one. Can you bring, thank you, sir. Now imagine on earth. Okay, this is earth. There is also altars on earth, isn't it?
Yeah.
Abraham made altar. Gideon established the altar. Altars, 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 altars. Thank you. This is the places of sacrifice. Remember Mount Moriah, also Moriah. This is an altar. And the problem is, God always provides the sacrifice for himself. Demons can't provide sacrifice for themselves. They need the sacrifice of others. God provided the sacrifice for himself. So that altars on the earth. When you made an altar on the earth, what was happening when those guys made the altar on the earth? They revisited the altars. Because they would usually build the altar where they had encounter with God. And what would happen? This place where the altar on earth was standing was an open port dimension. Because altar is the portal. If I don't have altar in my family, established in the spirit, how can things from heaven come into my family? They come through altar because God responds to what is happening at the altar. But now, we are not very much worried about the altars, to build the physical altars on earth, because we are the altar. It's us equals me equals altar. Altars. Don't you know, when you pray for deliverance for people who were involved in different demonic activities, what do you see in the spirit when you pray for them? Altars inside of them. When you pray for the Buddhist to be delivered, you will see the Buddhist shrines and Buddhas engraved in their souls. And these are those altars at which they physically worship, but the demon overshadowing them releases that projection of that altar into them. And they become the points of contact in that person. Or when you pray for the Satanist somewhere, you will see a pentagram, 100%. Because this is what they do. This is what they do. And so, yeah. And then the heavenly altar, through the whirlwind, is connected to the earthly altar. And angels ascend and descend. An interaction in the spirit starts taking place. So, these things need to be done consciously, but according to the revelation. according to the revelation. So, and today, we prophetically, I felt prophetically to start establishing altars in our congregation. That every time we get together, so when we practice and what we do today, it's not physical altar. We will consciously partake of it and then we will take it with us home. And wherever we are, we will practice an operation of that altar. Because I really believe, unless you see what was happening with the altars, constantly something was coming from the altar. It's not from time to time. The animals were burned on the burning offering, on the altar. Then in the holy place, there was altar of female, altar of worship, remember? And they, menorah and everything, and they need to be constantly burning, You had to supply the life on the altar. You can't just bring the sacrifice one day and 10 weeks later bring the sacrifice. We want God constantly move in our lives, but we are not constant towards Him. How can we expect Him being constant if we are not constant? That's why we as the altar, we are the living sacrifice, and our bodies are the living sacrifice, which is spiritual act of worship. And I believe as we do it prophetically, this altar will be established in each and every one of our lives. Then when we come together, what happens? These altars get combined depending on how much everybody practiced, but I will explain now. And then it becomes in the spirit a huge altar of something. Big one, which will be directly connected with a heavenly dimension, and people will receive the blessings and things through that altar. All right. The first altar, I really felt, you can give the subject, the first one, which needs to be restored, which we tried to establish and we prayed about, remember, in the old building, and we tried to put all sorts of things there and whatever. This is the, and you can practice, because now it's, after this prophetic action that we will do today, it will become part of you. And you will see, it's the altar of Melchizedek, priesthood. Melchizedek priesthood, altar of Melchizedek priesthood. Altar of Melchizedek priesthood. What is that altar? It's a Melchizedek star or Melchizedek seal, which we saw on the temple of Philip in Turkey. It's an 8-pointed star with cross inside. This is the altar of Melchizedek. Kashamaganda kasikana kitula kitoreseti, eroshikana sinikenteya.
Oh, rabati li histori ishtima pura kateya. Ei, zakrata kastile kestoro tu. Kitakatela kistura kiveveye. Genturi kim chuta kansi kintu putali isse. Ei, shamata kana. Erva zatri histori orkestena le vintu kateye. Halleluja. Sumra grako tiken tiketele izota. Ei, habitania.
We will wipe it out. We don't have to worry to leave it. My goodness, if somebody will look now, thinking, what the magic happening. So it's a... Why 8? Because the 8 is the number of new beginning. It's a new priesthood. Why 8? Because 8 is the number of resurrection. Resurrection. And this priesthood is because our high priest is risen from the dead. That's it. This is the altar of that priesthood. Imagine. This altar is in heaven. Because there is a priestly altar in heaven. Now, we draw it physically, in the physical dimension now here, that we may physically partake into today. But after we do it by faith, physically, when we leave this place, this whole structure will be projected by the Spirit into our inner being. We don't have to draw it anymore. We carry it on the inside. We can just practice, and then practice at home or wherever you are. Okay. Now, it's also the portal which opens 8 dimensions in the Spirit, enabling us as a priesthood to operate in 8 dimensions of the Spirit. You can listen, because if you feel we do it, you can do it. 8 dimensions. So, for we have come, we've gotten access to, what is the first dimension? Mount Zion. Zion. So you know here, this is that thing here. Point. Mount Zion. What is the Mount Zion? A realm of government and rulership of Yahweh. Government. Zion, government. So this is the first access. Second one, New Jerusalem. What is the dimension of New Jerusalem? Matrix of perfection. Mother. Our mother. Apostle Paul said. Matrix of perfection. New Jerusalem. The third one, the church of the firstborn who is in heaven. So actually, heavenly church which we have access into, so that with all the saints we may explore this the depth, length, height, and width. Fourth one, innumerable company of angels. Company of angels. Angelic realm, angelic network. Angelic network. Cooperation functioning with angels as a brand new priesthood. Next one. Spirits of the righteous who reach perfection. Spirits of the righteous. Who reach perfection. Second one, it means cloud of witnesses. Second one, the mediator of the new covenant, intercessor, Christ, Jesus Christ. Intercessor of new covenant. Jesus. Because priests intercede. And we are able to intercede with the intercessor. Another one, Father, who is the judge of all. Father, the judge. Judgments of God. We have access to judgments of God. David asked for his judgments. And we will release the judgments, legislate, give orders, if we know the judge. And the last one, blood of Jesus, speaking better than of Abel. The testimony and a record of blood of Jesus speaking. Speaking. When the altars are built in us and we get activated in these areas, we will be able to release that reel. Release 8 reels. Wherever we are, release 8 reels. And all these 8 reels will overshadow us. And we will become practical and we will be able to operate in this. And here is another altar. I felt about 2 altars today. Altar which we call Sozo. And we will just put the cross there. God doesn't like circles. Circular thing, so we will put squares. He likes squares. Circles, you know, it's pentagram and all this type of things. They're not drawing circles. What is the altar of Sozo? Altar of healing, altar of deliverance, restoration, and salvation. salvation, healing, four corners of the altar, yeah? Deliverance. It's a Greek word, sozo, which incorporates all four. Restoration. Zion and the government, New Jerusalem, you know, or maybe just inside of you, or just receive it. Just receive it. It's not intellectual matter, it's more like a spiritual matter. And then come to this altar, and then it's like when you step, you just take all of that, you wrap all of that, or put it here, and it's already part of you. All right. Thank you, Lord, for the establishment in our hearts, in our being, the altar of the priesthood, the altar of the Melchizedek priesthood, the highest priesthood in the universe, the only priesthood which is now acknowledged by you, which was with an oath, confirmed and established with an oath. And as we, Lord, release and by faith activate according to the revelation these altars, we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will engrave, impart, and project these altars into our being. That wherever we are, we will be sealed up. That these altars will be sealed up in our being. That wherever we need to release these things, or to activate these things, or be activated in them for our purpose, or for the purpose of others, it will take place. Because we are those altars. They are part of us. They are not this just drawn pictures on the ground. Father, but you are here to give the witness to this prophetic event, Lord. Thank you that you gave us and granted us access to go into all these eight realms. For all these eight realms to overshadow us. That we will be working, functioning, and operating in these eight realms, Father. As we are granted access and release and manifest these eight realms. Hallelujah. So let the realm of Mount Zion be released. The realm of government and the rulership of Yahweh. Let the New Jerusalem realm be released, a matrix of perfection. Let the realm of heavenly church of the firstborn be released, that we may interact with the heavenly church on a regular basis. Let the realm of innumerable company of angels be released and activated. Angelic network operations and interactions. Let the realm of the spirits of righteous be released and activated as the men in white linen and cloud of witnesses. Let the intercessory work of Jesus Christ, finished work of the cross, and new covenant reality as the intercessor of the new covenant Jesus be released into our lives. Let the realm of the Father the Judge be released into our lives. And let the testimony and the record of the blood of Jesus speaking be released for all these realms to manifest their substance and operations in our lives on a daily basis.
One more thing which I forgot about this one,
but we are in the process of activating. What you actually release also in that eight stuff. First one, light. It's a priesthood of light. Father, your supernatural uncreated life, light. What is another one? Consuming fire. Operation of consuming fire. To operate in the realm of consuming fire. The third one, power of life. This priesthood is operating in indestructible power of life. Indestructible. It's all according to Hebrew. Power of life, book of Hebrew. That this will be released and activated. Next, grace and mercy. Grace and mercy substance. Next one, limitlessness. Limitlessness. Time and space. Remember? This priesthood operates neither genealogy nor, so we are not bound to time and space, limitlessness. Another one, the priesthood of love. The priesthood of love. Another one is truth and rest. And the last one, glory. Father, and as we will release your glory, your light, your consuming fire, your indestructible power of life, grace and mercy, limitlessness over time and space, love, truth and rest into each and every area of our lives. And let it come upon us and our families and our households and saturate, penetrate and start working first in us and our families before we start releasing it. And Father, also this altar of Sozo, where the power of restoration, power of salvation, power of healing, and power of deliverance will be released into us to bring us into order and restore, heal, deliver, and bring salvation to our souls and our bodies, that all those 90 rooms will be cleared and cleansed. We are not going to tolerate, we need to fight, and we are not going to tolerate sicknesses.
Yeah.
And regularly, we will just start praying for each other. It's like from the next service, everybody who is sick, they will just come out, declare what is the problem, and in turns, we will practice it. Like one Sunday, two people coming like them, and just release the healing and restoration into us. Another some of us that we by all practice. That eventually it's just like There's no tolerance for sicknesses, for diseases, for demons anymore. Finished. Bye. All right. So I'm playing. I will take because last time we didn't have it. Our practical part, definitely don't say please extremely low. Because there we are like few people. You just stand on the inside, go into the presence of God, and then by faith you step and you know what you are stepping into. And then on that altar, blood and body, and finished. And you can wait for others. But also receive some substance by faith, and I believe. And how you do it at home? Or wherever you are. Father, I release and activate the realm of Zion into my life and family, into my spirit, soul, and body, into my children. I release and activate the light of God and the consuming fire and the new Jerusalem dimension where the matrix of perfection will start appearing. Because altars need to be supported by practice and prayer. It's not just one small thing. When you feel it, you can do it. That the fire on the altar will keep coming, and the connections will be stronger and stronger with heavenly altars. And then we will open, just walk in the realm easily. And we will see that automatically these things will start taking place in our lives and also in the lives of other people. It's for all the saints, it's not for apostles, prophets, just pastors, evangelists, and teachers. All right. So yeah, practical. We have like 15 minutes. Let it be to us if we give you a word. Written word. and the 8 girl wings. Let them regularly start taking us into those dimensions. Thank you, Lord. It's all because of your blood, because of your cross, because of your sacrifice. You're the greatest altar. Your cross was the greatest altar. And we honor you. You are the greatest sacrifice. And we honor you as the greatest sacrifice. The greatest blood, your blood, was shed. And the greatest work, your will, was accomplished. And we will walk in the finished will of the cross. We will walk in the fullness of resources, supplies, and provisions of the realms of heaven. We will walk in the new creation reality as a new creation man, as the sons of the living God. Every other realm which is not your realm, every other dimension which you haven't opened in our lives, every other realm and dimension of darkness and kingdom of darkness in us and against us and around us, let them be shut and sealed. We don't belong there.